And what?
Forever.
That's right. Here we go.
Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King, for his love endures forever. For he's good, he is above all things, his love endures forever. We sing praise.
With a mighty hand,
with a mighty hand, and an outstretched arm, his love endures forever. For the life that has been before, his love endures forever.
Sing praise,
sing praise. We sing praise,
sing praise. Come on.
From the rising to the setting sun, his love endures forever. And by the grace of God, we will carry on. His love endures forever.
Sing praise.
Sing praise. Sing praise.
Come on, church, sing it out.
Faithful and true. Hey, let's turn around and greet one another this morning. Turn around and say hello to somebody next to you. The joy of the Lord this morning.
Love to hear that chatter out there and that hugs and the waves. Good morning. Good morning, Grace Fellowship family. Today is the first day in our Advent season, so you'll see our Advent table over here. What a tremendously hectic time it is right now. You go ahead and everyone can have a seat. We've got decorating to do inside, outside, baking, photo cards, Christmas cards if you do those still. We've got a lot of holiday get-togethers, a lot of plans, parties, meals, cooking, you name it. There's a whole lot of wrapping presents. There's a whole lot of activities going on that keep us pretty occupied. So oftentimes we're so full of activities that we become overwhelmed and don't take time to really think about the reason for the season, being the gift of us given to us by our Father, Jesus, our Savior. So we want to add an element to our worship each Sunday morning between now and our yearly Christmas Eve service, being the Advent worship. So as we reflect on hope today, let us put ourselves in the worn-out shoes of the Israelites, a people in exile under the yoke of foreign powers, waiting with great hope for the coming of Messiah.
As early as the 4th century, the church has been celebrating specific events in the life of Christ. Two of these events, the first one was the cycle of life, beginning on Ash Wednesday and following up through Lent, all the way up to Easter. The second one being the cycle of lights, which is the 4 Sundays leading up until Christmas. If the second one is celebrated properly, it helps us focus our hearts, our minds, our souls on the expectant coming of Christ the Messiah. And just as the Jewish community eagerly awaited the coming of the promised Messiah, so we, the adopted heirs of God's kingdom through Christ, eagerly await his second coming.
The word Advent is from the Latin word Adventist, which simply means coming or the coming of Christ. The wreath around the candle symbolizes the nature of God, his eternity and his endless mercy. The wreath not only symbolizes eternal life, but also the newness and renewal for those who have gained salvation. The candle represents Jesus, the light of the world. Hence, the celebration of the cycle of lights. The traditional theme for this first Sunday of Advent is hope. The hope for the Jewish community that day came through the prophecies given through their awaited Messiah. Prophecies such as Isaiah 7:14, "The Lord himself shall give you a sign. A virgin shall be with child and give birth to a son, and will call him Emmanuel."
Prophecies like Jeremiah chapter 33, verses 14 through 16. It says, "Behold, days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will fulfill the good work which I have spoken concerning the house of Israel and the house of Judah. In those days and at that time, I will cause a righteous branch of David to spring forth, and he shall execute justice and righteousness on the earth. In those days, Judah will be saved, and Jerusalem will dwell in safety." Isaiah chapter 9, verses 6 through 7. "For unto us a child is born, and a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end."
As we light the first candle of Advent, we are called with hope because we know that the prophecies of old have come to pass, given to a people waiting for centuries, the fulfillment of the promised deliverer, the Messiah, Jesus. This promise fulfilled only works to strengthen our own hope of prophecies yet to be fulfilled, prophecies such as Revelation 21, 1 through 4, "And then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Behold, the tabernacle of God is among the people, and he will dwell among them, and he shall be and they shall be his people. And God himself shall be among them, and he will wipe away every tear from their eyes, that there will no longer be any death. There will no longer be any mourning or crying or pain, for these things shall pass away."
The Sunday of Hope. Hope. Like a seed that is buried deep within the earth, hidden, covered by layers, buried, yet stretching, growing, becoming hope. Hope, like a seed becoming, so is our new life with Christ. Maverick's going to come and light our first Advent candle. Father, we light this candle for your Son, our Lord, Jesus Christ, who is the light of the world. We who have sat in darkness and have seen a great light, the light of hope, the light of salvation, we give you thanks and praise in Jesus' name, because he lives with you in glory. Amen.
Why don't you sing with us? O come, Emmanuel.
O come, Emmanuel. Shem ransom captive. That mourns in lowly exile here, until the Son of God appears. Rejoice, rejoice,
come thou day spring.
Oh, come thou day spring, come and cheer our spirit by thine advent here. Disperse the gloomy cloud of night and death's dark shadow. Put to flight.
Rejoice
and rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel.
O come, thou wisdom.
O come, thou wisdom from on high, and order all things far and nigh. To us the path of knowledge show, and cause us in her way to go.
All God's people said, and
rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel.
Rejoice one more time.
Shall come to thee, O Israel.
At this time, the children, I believe, are dismissed. And if we can have a listen, come on up.
Good morning, everybody. It's so good to see you all here today. Did you all have an amazing Thanksgiving? Yeah, that was very unenthusiastic. Yeah, it was good, yeah? Yeah, we're so excited to hear you, have you guys here today. If we have anybody new here with us, we have Connect cards, and you can raise your hand, and somebody can pass those out to you, and you can fill it out and take it to the welcome counter in the lobby after church, and we have a gift. And that is just a way for us to know who you are, know that you're here, and reach out to you and get to know you a little bit better. If you've been coming here and you haven't filled out a Connect card and you would like to, we would love to have you do that. You still have a chance, and you still have a chance to get a free gift. Yay, yeah? But we just here, we love fellowship here. We love getting to know each other. We are such a close body here, and we want to include you in on that. So make sure you fill one of those out. Who has already set up their Christmas tree at home? Yeah, who set it up like before Thanksgiving? Yeah, we got some of those. Who is a nut like my husband and said, no way, we have to wait till like December to set it up? Yeah, some people, they want to keep it special. Well, if you would like to help us today, we are going to start setting up for Christmas here after church, and we have a bunch of Christmas trees that we need to bring down. So if you are able to help us out with that, who do we see for that? Who? Oh, Leticia. Yeah? Oh, she looks very confused. Anyways, if you want to help us carry those down after church, hang around, and we would love for your help. Women's Ministries is hosting Seasters. Sorry. Do you know what I'm talking about? Mark Johnson knows. We watch Nacho Libre a lot in my house. Has anybody seen Nacho Libre? Right? It's a really awkward, super funny movie, and the guy has a horrible accent, and he always says Seasters, so in my house, we say Seasters. Is it Nacho Libre themed, Martha? This event? That'd be fun, huh? No, but Women's Ministries is having a Sisters event, and it's just a get-together, fellowship, fun, cookies. It's a cookie exchange, and it's on Wednesday, December 15th, from 6:30 to 8 in Barrett Hall. And they are doing sign-ups, I think, for that out in the lobby. Yes? Yes. Please sign up for that. We have a lot of events. If you guys notice in your bulletins, we have a lot of events coming up this month. So make sure you look at that and come to all of them. We also have an amazing event coming up December 4th, which is, oh, no, I'm sorry. Oh, my gosh, Sierra's going to be so mad at me. December 3rd. Scratch the 4th from your mind. Scratch it out. December 3rd. It's this Friday. We are having a showing of The Chosen. Have you guys watched The Chosen show? Anybody? Yes? I've never seen it. I know, it's bad. But they are doing a movie, and we have an opportunity to show that here. So we want everyone to come. We want you guys to invite people. We have an event on Facebook, and you can share that, and you can pre-buy tickets either on our website or on Facebook. And that is, again, this Friday, December 3rd at 7 here at Grace. If by chance you don't buy a ticket before, just show up and you can buy a ticket at the door. But we are very, very excited about this. Last? Guys, I haven't done announcements in a long time. I'm very thrown off. I'm so sorry about this. Okay, we have a few ways to give at Offering. You can give at the online app, the Give Plus app. You can mail in your giving, or you can put it in the box after church. But we encourage you to give with a happy heart here to our church. And, yeah, that's all I have for you. So happy Sunday.
Well, I want to wish you a good morning as well and happy Thanksgiving / entering into the Christmas season. I wanted to give an announcement this morning that this upcoming Tuesday, you probably have seen some advertisement in the community that it is officially Giving Tuesday, this upcoming Tuesday, November 30th. And to help explain a special opportunity we have partnered with different charities in Amador County. These are all giving to local charities here. And there are certain partnerships, people that have donated money to match up to a certain number, those donations that are happening on this Tuesday. So we have partnered with several. The one I'm going to highlight this morning is New Hope Home. And to do that, I'm going to ask Janet to come on up here. Janet is one of the founding members, a board member of New Hope Home, a wonderful ministry that you see as you come up our driveway to the right, our beautiful Victorian there with beautiful, lovely ladies there who are a part of that ministry. So Janet, tell us, I'm going to talk a little bit more about Giving Tuesday and what that is, but tell us about, remind us what Hope Home is and what we're trying to accomplish with this building out here.
New Hope Home has been built by God to bring hope to these ladies, just like we are celebrating today. And many women come out of rehabs having struggled. A lot of them have burnt their bridges, don't have any place to go. But if they do go back home without support, without help, without change, they fall right back into it. So we are the in-between. We are the place where it's safe to come, to feel God's love, know that he is their redeemer. And they have, we have all kinds of programs they are set up to do, Bible studies and AA meetings and various things, and practical things like how to clean your house and how to cook and skills for coping for when they are ready to go out. We've had many ladies that have been successful. Some have not, but God's not giving up on them yet either.
Right.
And we even have one lady who's looking at starting their own Hope Home in another county that's gone through our program. So we feel that God is definitely holding those ladies, and that we supply the home and the love, and they all have to pay a fee to be there. It's a program fee, not a rent. And so some of them work, that's the goal, or if they can't, they have to volunteer. So we just raise funds to support these ladies, give them a chance.
So this is a ministry to these precious women who are in that vulnerable place of transitioning from maybe some cases homelessness or in a program of sobriety and so on, to give them a safe environment to thrive. And all of the programs and investments that Janet has mentioned are happening in an ongoing way. Our manager over there, her name is Tammy Jo. She lives there full time with these women, and it's just been a beautiful thing that God has birthed in the hearts of so many who made this happen. And we're so happy just to provide the building. Now we do charge them rent over there, $1 a month, but so that means that there are so many churches, so many people in our community who are investing to actually make this happen. We all share in the load. Even though the ladies are paying part of their living expenses there, of course, there's so many aspects of ongoing expenses to maintain this building and to maintain an environment. It takes all of us working together to help with that. Giving Tuesday is that great event that our local community and larger, but the donations that you make on Tuesday, November 30th, this upcoming Tuesday, goes to these charities that we support, specifically this morning highlighting New Hope Home. Now, it's important you know how your money might be matched. So there's a certain amount of donations that come in to match up to a certain point. When that money runs out, it's no longer matched, but your money does all 100% go to New Hope Home when you designate it as such. So in your bulletin, there's information. There's three ways. We provide three ways to give. They do too. One is online, two are in person. And the important part of it is the donations you make have to be made on Tuesday for it to count as far as to be eligible for a potential match, to those funds to be matched and go further than the normal donation. And so that information is in your bulletin this upcoming Tuesday. Janet, how else can we be praying for the ministry, or if there's any other information that would be helpful for us as we consider contributing to this ministry?
Well, if you think about the women that are there right now that have no homes, no families, they want to be with their families. Some of them have lost their children. Pray for their hearts. Pray for just healing in their lives and comfort and maybe the ability someday to make peace with their families. It would just be really good to pray for that. And also I wanted to say, we have bulletin brochures out in the mission section. We've had them for years. If anybody wants more information, you're welcome to pick up a brochure. You might know somebody that needs this service. You might know somebody that's hurting right now that might want to check it out. So please, it's not just about Giving Tuesday. We're always willing to talk to the ladies to see if we can help them. Okay.
So as you exit today in the lobby, if you turn left, that's our missions corner, and that information is there. And one final question I have is, sometimes we're at full capacity over there, and sometimes we're not. Are there spaces available right now?
There still are, yes.
So, yeah, if you know someone who could benefit from this program, consider reaching out to Janet. Sure. Pick up this information and follow up with that.
Yes, we'd love to talk to you. And we always pray about the ladies that come in. They don't just come in to live there. They come in with a purpose. So it is God's home, and it's his arms reaching them.
Amen. Well, thank you so much, Janet.
Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall, but you have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won, for you have never failed me yet. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. Still in your hand. This is my confidence. You never failed me yet. I know the night won't last. Your word will come to pass. My will sing your praise again. Jesus, you're still enough. Keep me within your love. My heart will sing your praise again. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. I'm still in your hand. This is my confidence. You never fail. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. Still in your head, this is my confidence. You never fail me again. You made a way Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. I'm still in your hand. This is my confidence. You never fail me yet. You never fail. Yeah, I never will forget. You never fail me
up here and they're gone. As we gather this morning, I'm so thankful to see all of you, my brothers and sisters. Table fellowship is a vital part of who we are, as Steve taught a couple weeks ago. As we grow in humility and in unity together, just as Christ, God the Father, and the Holy Spirit are unified, as are we, his beloved bride. You see the beautiful tables before us. I want to welcome you to come and take your elements as the band plays. Take that time to praise God, repent, listen, worship. As you sit and wait till everybody is done, and then we'll take our communion together.
While they were eating, Jesus took bread, and he had given thanks. He broke it, he gave it to the disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body." Then he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins."
After Jesus said this, they were very much present in that moment with him, not quite understanding. And then he turned their attention to the future. He says to them, "I tell you, I will not drink from this fruit of the vine from now on until the day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom." He's looking forward, and he's sharing, looking forward to being with them again and us in his new kingdom someday. So as we celebrate his death, his burial, and resurrection, we're also looking forward to his kingdom. May it come soon.
Sing this last verse together. Mansions of glory.
Ability to share your story with those around us, Father, that people may come to love you as we love you. Father, we praise you and we thank you for today and for who you are and all that you've done for us, Lord. We are grateful. We give you glory and honor this morning in your name. Amen.
Our worship service this morning certainly has been meaningful and full. I love that. I love the fullness of our experience from the moment we walk in this door to the moment we walk out. It's such a celebration of what God is doing in our midst. And I really appreciate each person's participation, your roles. We each one play an important part of building up the body of Christ. So thank you, everyone who is involved in all of this is happening and even behind the scenes here. And so good, so good. So many things to be thankful for. This morning, I wanted to let you know, some of you have undoubtedly already heard the news, but I have sad news that one of our church members, Raylene Wigglesworth, tragically was killed in a car accident this last week, and right here, out here on Highway 49. And Raylene has been a part of Grace for many years, had moved out of the area and then recently moved back into the area, and she'd been here attending regularly. Once again, just last Sunday, I had the opportunity to pray with her, and she was had rededicated her life to the Lord recently and was looking forward to pursuing a reconciliation process with family members that she loved, that were wounded perhaps by some of her choices and so on. That was her heart, to serve the Lord and to make peace with her family. And we don't know what tomorrow brings. And we mourn with the family. Our prayers go out to Raylene's family, many of whom attend Grace here, Sandy, Roxy, Tasha, their son Andrew. And so we mourn. We mourn as we also give thanks. And that seems contradictory at some level. But when you've lived life for any length, somehow it doesn't. You see that there's both many times in our life experience. As we move forward in today's service, I just invite us to come before the Lord in prayer. So grateful for Martha's prayer leading us into this moment, and I want to just reflect for myself a bit. Will you join me? Father, we are so grateful for your love for us, and even as our hearts are sad when we lose loved ones, and we don't always have the answers as to why. God, we do know without doubt that you love us. You have demonstrated your love toward us in sending your son, Jesus, to himself die a horrific death, so to have a relationship, to make it possible for us to have a relationship with you. Thank you. Thank you. And so we ask your blessing upon our day, this last part of our worship service as we open up your word. God, speak to us uniquely today as we open our hearts to you. And we pray this in the name of your son, Jesus. Amen. Well, as we continue our study in Acts, I invite you to open your Bible to Acts chapter 16. If you are a regular attender of Grace, you know we've been studying through the book of Acts, as we do very regularly. Take a book of the Bible and study verse by verse. And this morning we are in Acts chapter 16, and we're just reading five verses, or studying five verses, rather, 6 through 10. Acts 16, verses 6 through 10. It's a unique section that serves, you know, you think about what purpose does this small section of Scripture serve. There's no teaching elements in it, and it, in fact, points out a mysterious part of the Apostle Paul's missionary journey. Now, Paul and Barnabas have already gone on one missionary journey that has been very successful in proclaiming the gospel both to Jews and to Gentiles, though not without cost. Paul himself, his life being threatened and execution even carried out against him, thinking he was dead. They drug him out of the city, but he survived miraculously. And now Paul and Silas have joined forces, and they are embarking on the second missionary journey. There'll be three that are recorded in Acts. And they're initially going out to the churches they've most recently visited to deliver a letter proclaiming the good news of Jesus, particularly to Gentiles, and clarifying that the gospel is about faith in Jesus alone, in his work, his accomplishment on the cross. And the righteousness to be declared righteous by God himself is to believe, put our faith, our trust in Jesus and his finished work on the cross. That's all it took. There was no additional requirements of, for instance, converting to Judaism, which had been the case for centuries previous to this. And so they're happily delivering this letter to these churches, to Lystra, to Iconium, to Antioch, and then they looked forward to going to new domains, new parts that they had, regions that they had not visited previously. And Paul would say in his letter to the Romans that he made it his goal to present the gospel in places where it's never been heard before. And so he was excited, I would imagine. He and Silas, and they picked up Timothy as their new travel partner, picked Timothy up in Lystra. And now they're going out to regions unknown for the express task of proclaiming the good news of Jesus. They were commissioned to this end by their sending church in Antioch. And these verses tell us, as Luke records them, what these opening days, weeks perhaps, was like. It wasn't what they expected. In fact, far from it. And so today, the theme of today's message in this passage is adjusting expectations. We have a certain understanding of maybe how our day will go, or we have a plan that's not too far out in the future, and if we work hard enough toward it, we're going to achieve that goal. Our day, as we set out to accomplish the things we have for that day, the people we're going to talk to, the decisions we're going to make, many of them we thought about them beforehand. We have a pretty good idea of how things are going to go. Many of our days, one after another, are fairly predictable. Because that's true, when things don't go the way we want them, or the way we'd prefer, or the way we'd expect, it is oftentimes kind of throws us off, and sometimes tragically, and oftentimes in a way that just is frustrating. And you're thinking, God, why is this happening? Why today? Why am I getting this flat tire? Why is this extra challenge happening today? Adjusting expectations. So we're going to learn from the Apostle Paul as Luke records his responses to things not going exactly the way they might have expected. So, as a part of an outline this morning, the first major point we're going to be presented by the text itself is the restriction. They've gone out for the express purpose of telling people about Jesus. And suddenly, God himself puts a restriction on their activity. So let's read the text. If you have your Bible open, we're going to read from Acts chapter 16. I'm going to read the first three verses here, 6 through 8, which says this. And they went through the region of Phrygia and Galatia, having been forbidden by the Holy Spirit to speak the word in Asia. Asia, in this context, it contains cities like Ephesus. Ephesus, a whole letter is written to Ephesus. Paul would, on his third missionary journey, spend 3 years there. We know God wants the gospel in Ephesus, in the provinces of Asia, but right now, no. Forbidden from speaking the gospel. Verse 7, and when they had come to Mysia, they attempted to go into Bithynia. These are regions, but the Spirit of Jesus did not allow them. So passing by Mysia, they went down to Troas. Troas is a coastal city right at the edge there at the Aegean Sea. They've run out of room. They've traveled in a northwesterly fashion, and now they come right up to the Aegean Sea. There's no place to go. They stop there after being forbidden from the Holy Spirit to preach the gospel or to go into certain regions to visit those areas. I don't know about you, but I'd be asking the question, why? I mean, this was my whole purpose. I'm here. I'm excited. We've gathered a team. We've been commissioned by God to go to these areas. Why are we not being allowed to preach the gospel, the very thing that God wants us to do? We want to bring God glory, and God himself forbids it. Frustration. Difficulty. Let me just say this. Luke never answers this question. They never say why. God never reveals some later, you know. Oftentimes I love to look at later passages or other things and I'm kind of connect the dots and like, here's the secret, you know. Here's what's really happening. But if you search the New Testament, you're never going to come to a real clear understanding as to why God was forbidding the gospel from being preached in this area, these areas. Why would that be true? Why? And the reason I point that out, I want to draw attention to that. For one, Luke, it's important to him that this somehow is recorded for us. We're supposed to be learning from it at some level. And so we have to discern, what is it that we're supposed to learn? One thing I believe is that oftentimes the way God moves, as we experience it, is mysterious. I don't know why. Sometimes something strange happens or painful happens and we ask that question. And oftentimes I, as a pastor, get asked that question, why do you think this happened? Why isn't God answering this prayer? Why is the outcome going this way when God could easily glorify it if he just interacted right now, interceded and brought salvation or healing or protection in some supernatural way? Why is he choosing not to interact or to withhold something good, it would appear, from our human standpoint? And often my answer is limited to, I don't know. I don't know. And then my heart is simply to walk with individuals who are going through uncertain, unclear times. So we're not alone, first of all. Paul himself, the apostle, who is a direct link to God, right? He can perform miracles. He's healed people. He's raised people from the dead. Paul, the apostle. And he is, for some mysterious reason, being forbid from doing something that he was commissioned to do by God himself. So let's just let that lie there for a moment as we kind of navigate what they might have thought, what they might have felt, and glean from it using kind of the wisdom of the scriptures themselves. Which leads us to our second major point is, what is resulting here? What's happening in because their way is being thwarted, because God is forbidding it? What is going on that we can guess at with some accuracy, because it's really their experience is our experience. And the scriptures tell us those who are going through difficult times, trials, tribulations, here are certain things that happen. You are refined, right? Your character grows. You're learning to trust in the Lord in a more deep way. And maybe in hindsight, as if enough time has passed, we can look back on that time and understand, whoa, that's why that happened. In the case of Joseph, we think about this, right? It wasn't until years later, the very end of the book of Genesis, his brothers are interacting with him, and he says, you know what? They're thinking he's going to have some retribution toward them because they mistreated him so poorly. And he says, you know what? What you meant toward me, evil, the evil you meant toward me, God meant for good. I would argue that Joseph didn't always have that perspective. He didn't know why he was being threatened to be killed by his brothers, subsequently sold into slavery, subsequently falsely accused of rape, subsequently imprisoned for years and seemingly forgotten, only to be brought out of prison to be lifted up to the second in command over the granaries of all of Egypt, put in a position to rescue not only the inhabitants of Egypt, but his own family from a coming famine. It wasn't until that very end goal, till all that comes out, that I'm sure that Joseph began to say, oh, I get it. I needed to be here And the way God brought about my being in this place for this given time was the path that I didn't understand when I was going through it. And so as we go through those times of mystery, we trust God that good is being worked out, though we don't understand it. It doesn't feel good. It hurts, actually. It's frustrating. It makes me angry at times when things aren't going the way I think they ought to. So what is happening? What are the character traits we know that I think that if we observe Paul and his traveling companions, what are their actions kind of denote? What kind of character traits? So the result, I think, of this, there's a few of them, a few examples. One is they're learning to trust. Learning to trust. And all of these really are become application points for us, going through similar circumstances where we don't understand what's happening. Why did things happen the way they are? Why are these expectations I had, which are good, they're good things? Why is God not allowing them to reach their fulfillment? One is to learn to trust. And we see them yielding to the Holy Spirit. I don't know how the Holy Spirit is speaking to Paul. Luke doesn't tell us that. We know that Silas, who's with them, we've already been told he's a prophet. Perhaps God is speaking through Silas. Maybe God is speaking to Paul in some sort of dream. We're not given any of that information as to how they understood the Holy Spirit was telling them not to do these things. But we can discern that the Holy Spirit wasn't given in the big picture because they keep traveling. They keep traveling with the expectation that they are going to preach the gospel. Okay, if it's not here, it must be in the next city. They travel on only to have another message. Again, oh, nope, it's not here either. Well, what about that city? Nope, not there. So they're traveling, they're moving in a way with very limited information. And they're really walking quite literally by faith from city to city, town to town, along these well-traveled routes, wondering, all the while just trusting God that we're moving in the right direction, heading here, ultimately get all the way to the end of the landmass here, up to the Aegean Sea, right there in Troas. And okay, we've run out of space here. More questions than answers. So they don't have a lot of information. So they're yielding to the Holy Spirit. They're aligning their conduct, their thinking, their actions to the direction of the Holy Spirit. And this made me think of this verse in Proverbs that sometimes we quote, and it might be familiar to you. Proverbs 3, verses 5 and 6, which says, "Trust in the Lord." These are words of wisdom, right? "Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will make straight your paths." Sometimes our life just doesn't make sense. When we lean on our own understanding, our limited ability to perceive wisely what exactly is happening right now, we lack the ability to see it clearly. And so God is telling us through verses like these and others that those times you've kind of exhausted your own understanding of why or what or what direction to go, no longer lean on that. Lean on me, my will. And I will direct your path. I will direct the next step. And this is what we see them doing. They're leaning on the Lord, taking another step of faith. Is this the place? Nope. Taking another step of faith and moving and learning in this whole process to trust the Lord more fully. Another result in their experience here is that they are learning dependence. I don't know about you. I don't like being dependent on anyone, putting my life into someone else's hands and they're making decisions. That involves a lot of trust. Okay, we're learning trust and we're learning dependence. I want to have a say in what happens in my life and the decisions and so on. I want to be independent, right? But the Christian life requires of us to put our lives squarely in the hands of God. And we trust him. Jesus said this, speaking to his disciples. Now, this is the eve before he is crucified, before his trial, and so on. He's saying this to them. He says, "Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. Remain, abide, remain in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever abides in me or remains in me and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. I love this, how the disciples, the apostles here, are so dependent upon their need for the Holy Spirit to lead them, so dependent on Jesus, that they will not do anything apart from his direction. Doesn't make sense. The whole reason they're out there is to preach the gospel. It does not make sense not to preach the gospel. Yet they won't take another step unless they have clear direction from God that is telling them to do so. They assume God wants them to do that until God says, no, don't do it. And so they're depending on the Lord. I want to just draw this idea out a little bit further in the sense that oftentimes when we get into a position where we don't know what's happening and why and the mystery part of it, it's kind of irritating, kind of frustrating. Unless we're already remaining deeply connected with God on a very regular basis, we have few tools to navigate when things go wrong. We get frustrated far too easily. It's hard enough to have our expectations altered, but we don't have this sense of daily investment in our relationship with God, who is speaking to us by the Holy Spirit, we're yielding to the Spirit and to Jesus. We're cultivating this deep relationship and communion with God through his son Jesus. It is very difficult to navigate with wisdom when things don't go the way we think they ought to. And here, Paul, there's this saying that we've been using, that we've quoted from Pete Scazzaro in a book that we've recently been studying, the importance of being versus doing, or being before we do. Oftentimes we think, I'm just going to go do things. I want to do this, I'm going to do that, I'm going to make these plans, I'm going to accomplish this, and certainly this is why Paul is called to preach the gospel and to do these things, these ministries, but all the while he is being with Jesus. He is listening to the Holy Spirit so that his doing doesn't overstep the communion he has with Jesus. So I can relate to this a bit as a leader, is that when you're in kind of new ground, new territory, and you have a group that is with you, that are there serving alongside you, but they're looking to you for leadership, and then all of a sudden there's more questions than answers, all the eyes kind of turn to you. And they go, okay, Paul, in this case, what are we going to do? The Holy Spirit told us not to preach. That's a new idea. We're pretty sure that's why we left. So what do you think, Paul? What are we going to do? What's our plan? So there's a tremendous amount of pressure on a leader at that point to say, to formulate a plan. Okay, well, this is what we're going to do. Internally you're going, I have no idea. I don't know why this is. I don't know why God has done this. But so I don't lose face with all of you who are looking to me for leadership, I'm going to come up with a plan that sounds really good and wise. And sometimes we have that pressure to lead in that way. But what does Paul do? He says, here, let me tell you what the plan is. We're going to wait. We're going to pray. We're going to seek the Lord because I don't know what to do. I love this leading that Paul does in this way. It's okay. Let's not freak out. I don't know why this is happening. Let's stop and wait. If you study the Psalms with any length of time, you'll find over and over and over a common theme in the Psalms is the psalmist crying out in a particular situation that they would not prefer to be in, but ultimately resolving to wait on the Lord, to trust him. He alone is going to rescue. He alone is my salvation. He will direct our steps, and so we're going to wait on him. And so we learn this dependence by slowing down and having rich communion with Jesus in the waiting, before we simply go out and create a plan of doing, learning dependence. I imagine there's some humility that comes along with this. Rather than having a big game plan, you feel like you're in control. We're going to do step one, step two, step three. We're going to accomplish that city. We're going to preach the gospel there. God willing, we're going to move on to that city over there. Now all those plans are lifted. Humility. You're going to have to trust the Lord, dependent on him. Humility follows. Here's one of the thoughts that Luke doesn't mention, Paul doesn't mention, but in other scriptures, this is a thought. It kind of strikes at the heart of, Paul, you're not the only one that God uses. It's not all on you. You're doing nothing right now. You're waiting. And that's okay. I have other people who are preaching the gospel. Remember, Barnabas and John Mark are out there preaching the gospel right now, while Paul is getting the red light. Other disciples are going from city to city proclaiming the gospel. We know this is happening. Not Paul. And in fact, Paul comments on this when he's in prison later in his life, and he writes to the Philippians. He said, here I am in prison, stopped from preaching the gospel in the cities that I prefer to preach in. And in fact, other people are emboldened to preach the gospel, if only to stir up trouble for me, to think that they're out there advancing the kingdom, and me, the great apostle, has been silenced in prison. Paul says, well, they got it wrong. It's okay. It's okay that I'm here. As long as the gospel's being preached, it doesn't have to be me. It doesn't all depend on me. Even if they're doing it with false pretense, false motives, the gospel's being preached. And for that, Paul says, sitting in prison, I rejoice. And that's why I'm here. In fact, I started a whole new prison ministry to the Praetorian Guard. He said, that's my new ministry. I'm going to preach to these guys I'm chained to. So humility is a part of that. We think, you know, if God doesn't use me, who's he going to use? He's called me. I'm supposed to be doing this. No. More than one person out there using their gifts. Doesn't have to be you. Wait. But somebody else is going to get an opportunity, and I may miss out on an opportunity. It's okay. I'm in control. Wait. How many people like waiting? Yeah, no hands. I'm right there with you. Don't like waiting. But it's sometimes necessary for us to learn humility, to move slowly, to not always have the answer to the mystery, to trust him, to be dependent on him. And of course, patience. If God is moving slowly, much more slowly than we would prefer, there's one character trait that we are developing, and that is, as we wait, we learn patience. And the Bible, of course, tells us that God is not, in fact, slow. We're just thinking of it from the wrong perspective. We're thinking about from my perspective, right here, what's right in front of me, that somehow I'm prevented from doing. God sees it from a grand perspective, that in his time frame, things are going exactly to plan. He is carrying out certain experiences and events that all will lead to Jesus returning, setting up his kingdom on earth. Those who rejected Jesus will be judged. The devil himself will be judged. Death itself will be judged. And we will enjoy all of eternity in that kingdom in the presence of God himself. Everything's working toward that end very steadily, very systematically according to God's plan. But if you're in the middle of that, you might be stuck in a part of the world or a part of history that feels very slow. Peter made this observation. Those who were telling him, everyone's waiting for Jesus, who had not yet come, they said, "What? He's delayed in his coming. He's not going to come at all then." So this is Peter's response. He says, "Do not overlook this one fact, beloved, that the Lord, with the Lord, is one day is 1,000 years. And 1,000 years is one day. The Lord is not slow to fulfill his promise, as some count slowness, right, from our perspective, but is patient toward you. He has a greater plan, not wishing that any should perish, but that all should reach repentance." How many people have ever prayed the prayer, "Lord, come today"? If you just came today and delivered us all from this world. That would be great. And I pray that in particular when things aren't going right and the expectations aren't being fulfilled, things aren't in order. I have some deadline that I'm not quite reaching. I have something that's hanging over my head that I wish weren't there. Lord, if you just came right now, amazing. Great. What is your delay, Lord? Because I'm thinking about me. I'm thinking about my experience. But God says, you know what? If I came today, there are hundreds and thousands of people who would not have the opportunity that you have to believe in me. Be patient. I'm bringing about all things in their due time. I'm lingering as long as I possibly can so that as many as possible can come to faith. And that's Peter's explanation as to when things aren't going along as quickly as we'd like. When is Christ returning? He's promised he would, and he's not. Be patient. God will fulfill his promise. And Paul would relate this to the already fulfilled promises. He talks about this in Galatians in chapter 3. He says, now before faith came, now this is the perspective of Israel as a nation, multiple generations of Israel as a nation. Before faith came, we were held captive under the law, imprisoned until the coming faith would be revealed. Now the coming faith to be revealed is the coming Messiah. So Israel had been promised Messiah for hundreds of years, and many prophets coming and saying, he's going to look like this, he's going to look like this, he's going to come during a time like this. Be watching, waiting for him, and generation would come, generation would go, and still no Messiah. They, as a nation, were used to waiting, held under the law, waiting for that day of redemption when Messiah would come. But he continues in Galatians, but when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption as sons. God is not slow in keeping his promises, and Jesus is a great example of that. Though hundreds of years can pass before a particular fulfillment, and many of those previous generations had to wait, Jesus, at just the right time, fulfilled that promise. And so he reflects in the same letter to the Galatians in chapter 6. So let us not grow weary in doing good, for in due season we will reap if we do not give up. We don't understand what's happening. We don't understand why God's not fulfilling our expectations, our hopes, and so on. We have to learn patience. God is not being slow. There are other things at work, certain elements that have to take place. So I don't know why that God didn't allow Paul to preach in Ephesus now. He will in the next journey. He'll be there for 3 years. Why not now? I don't know. But in his time, it will take place. So let's move to the last character trait that I wanted to bring out. And that is resilience. I hate this one. I've kept it for the last because I'm terrible at this. I don't feel very resilient. When my expectations, I think that my day is going to go a certain way, and it doesn't. It kind of knocks me down. And resilience is the idea of, okay, that's not how it's going to happen. I have to adjust. I have to stand back up and take another step forward with a new plan. I'm not good at that. I hate disappointment. And the beauty of these character traits is they're not something you just learn and then it's a static experience for the rest of your life. No, it's something we learn in an ongoing way every single day. So if you ever feel weak in any of these areas, patience, you know, we like to joke, I don't pray for patience. I prayed for patience once and I had the worst, you know, weeks of my life learning how to be patient and so on. These character traits are things that we're going to be learning over and over and over and growing in our understanding of them all our lives. And so resilience, you know, as terrible as I am at this character trait, I know God is going to give me plenty of opportunities the rest of my life to learn it. So I'm endeavoring to learn it so that, you know, maybe I can work on to a different character trait sometime in the future once I've learned this. This idea of holding our expectations with open hands. This is a phrase that I've adopted in my life that is that I try to live by. And that is, I have a certain expectation about how things go. And for a particular day, a particular month, a year, just in general, for life's experiences, life's relationships, hopes, dreams, whatever they are, I have these plans, right? I have expectations, what I think, how things ought to be in my life. But I'm trying to learn to hold those expectations with open hands, to say, God, this is how I think things ought to be and how I think my life should be, but I'm open. I'm open to what you would have for me. And when those expectations get thwarted or altered or changed, I'm going to feel that disappointment, but I'm going to do what I can to be resilient, to move forward and trust in you afresh. I normally hold my expectations like this. I think I'm holding like this until my expectations get bumped and thwarted and so on. I realize I've really tightened my grip on them. I kind of act, well, less than my age sometimes in my heart. You know, I get pouty. Martha, she teases me, you know, when our things don't happen exactly how they're going to happen, you know, what we hope to happen. And she teases me, Mark, is this going to ruin your whole day? Or, you know, we can move on. No, just give me time. I'm trying to be resilient. I'm adjusting my expectations. I actually literally say that to her. Just give me time. I'm adjusting my expectations. I've learned to say I'm not lowering. I'm lowering my expectations because sometimes I can feel offensive. No, I'm adjusting. God has a plan. God has a reality for me that I need to embrace and accept. And think about this in James in chapter 4, verses 13 through 15. Come now, you who say, today or tomorrow we will go into such and such a town, spend a year there, trade, make a profit, right? That's our normal language. Nothing bad with that, but while we say that, we have to hold it with open hands. This is James' comment. Yet you do not know what tomorrow will bring. What is your life? You are a mist that appears for a little time and then vanishes. We don't even know if we're going to live tomorrow, right? We have to make these plans, but instead, we ought to say, if the Lord wills, we will live and do this or that. That is making decisions with open hands. Having expectations. There's nothing wrong with expectations, but doing so with open hands. Lord, I want to do these things. I'm going to plan my life to do these things, but I hold them with open hands because I want you to have control of my life. I want you to direct my steps. Maybe my being slowed in one area is going to open up a door in another area that I just didn't see, but you see. Maybe my hope and dream in one area is going to provide a relationship, a connection I'm going to make with another person that will just change my life as a result. I can't see that. You can see it, God. So even though those alterations of my expectations are painful, God, I'm going to open my hands because I want your will to be done. You intend for me good. And though that path is painful sometimes, ultimately, I know you're going to lead me in a place that's best for me and potentially to further the gospel in ways I never even dreamed of. Resilience. Holding our will with open hands and say, Lord, your will be done. So, those are some of the observations. We do get some sort of resolution, though, by the time we get to the last part of this passage. There is a kind of a happy ending, right? They're right at the end of the coast. They're in Troas, and Paul has a vision. So, right, last two verses. And a vision appeared to Paul in the night. A man of Macedonia. See, that's across the Aegean Sea is Macedonia. They come right up to the ocean. On the other side, Macedonia. So he gets a vision in the night. This guy over there standing, urging him, saying, come over to Macedonia, help us. And when Paul had seen the vision, immediately we sought to go into Macedonia, concluding that God had called us to preach the gospel to them. So God finally gave him the green light. After whatever they were supposed, I don't know how many days, weeks, months, I don't know how long they've been waiting during this time and being obedient, learning patience, learning trust, learning dependence, learning resilience. But then God finally lifted the gates and said, here you go. Game on. We're going to Philippi, which which we're studying next week. So there is oftentimes resolution. We just don't know when it comes. We must learn in the process to hold with open hands and be patient. One little, last little tidbit I want to leave with us today before we move to our last song is a pronoun that were introduced for the very first time in the book of Acts. And that is this. We. You think, what's the significance of that? Up to this point, we've made the observation that always Luke, being the writer, has always spoken about Paul or Peter or other activities of Acts as they did this. He did this. Luke wasn't around. He wasn't with them. Remember, he's an historian. He's recording. He's gathered all the eyewitness testimony and so on. For the first time in the book of Acts, and it's such a subtle little moment, Luke joins the team. Luke is from Troas. Luke, perhaps, is the reason they arrived in Troas ahead of schedule. I don't know. We're guessing. But this is where Paul and Luke meet. And Luke joins the team. And now Luke will say, we went over to Macedonia, answering the call of God to preach the gospel. And I'm so grateful for Luke. And the thing is, if you try to do a character study of Luke or look, you know, you can't find anything about him. He never mentions his own name. He doesn't talk about his own experience. This is like the best we get. By the way, I'm a part of the team now. We. It's really subtle. I love that about Luke. We know from Paul, his letter to the Colossians, he mentions Luke the physician, so we know he's a doctor. We know from the book of Acts and also the Gospel of Luke, he's a historian, very capable guy. I'm grateful that Paul has a doctor with him at this point in his life. We know what happens to Paul. He's already been stoned once. He's going to be beaten several times, imprisoned. It's kind of good to have a doctor with you for what we know is ahead for Paul. And Luke becomes a wonderful traveling companion for Paul in more than one way. He's with him in prison, we'll read in later New Testament epistles. And so, as we conclude our time here together, and so many great elements of this worship service, one song was sung earlier. I'm going to invite the worship team back up here. That really ties into this idea of the waiting in between. We've seen God move in the past. But right now, maybe it feels a little bit like a desert. And we're trusting by faith that God will move again. We're waiting for that green light again. That God say, okay, this is what you're supposed to do next. You don't have to wait anymore. And we live these times by faith. Let's stand together as we conclude our service to sing this song.
promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. I'm still in your hand. This is my confidence. You never fail me yet.
Thankful for your love for us. Your promises are true, and we will wait for your faithfulness. You have not failed us, God. Help us to trust. Help us to be patient. Help us to be resilient afresh today. In Jesus' name. And everybody said,